So I guess we can start now, guys. And I'm really glad to see the participation from all over different parts of the world. And it really makes me happy that you guys are here to enjoy and to understand, to know more through this webinar. We are going to talk and discuss about how you can excel in your visa interview. A lot of people, and here we are talking about student visa. A lot of people want to go abroad and study. They want to have an education that is, they feel not just relevant into their own country, but which is globally accepted. And for that, they have to apply. They have to go through a lot of process. Of course, there is a lot of process involved in it. But one of the most important thing is visa interview. So this webinar and going in future, we will have a series of webinars which will be focusing specially on the visa aspect of foreign education. So let me share my screen with you guys so that you can have a better understanding of the topic. Brief presentation to help you understand what is student visa all about. So in this first session, we are going to focus completely on that. To begin with, I have some statistics with me. So this is the visa application statistics. It is for India as of now, only for India for the year 2016-17. If we look at the statistics, it is clearly visible that the number of applications is always more than the number of visas issued. As I couldn't get absolutely relevant data and absolutely trustworthy data for UK of number of applied applicants, I have not included that here. But as per the percentage that I have seen in the resources, in the government databases, it always is indicating that UK itself is becoming stricter in terms of student visa. And here we are talking only about India, but the if we see globally, the trend is similar. It is a similar trend all over. So everywhere, the number of applications are always more and the number of issuance of visa. And when we are talking about issue, the number issued here, a lot of these people are also those who, for whom the visa was earlier denied. So these are not always the fresh applicants only. So a number of them are repeaters of visa applicants. So we need to understand that there is always a gap between what the consulate wants and what the candidates are providing. And the gap can be bridged when we talk about these three parts. So to understand what a consulate wants, we need to focus on three main aspects. When we go to somebody who is consulting for visa, they often tell us a list of things that we require. Those are just the documents. What exactly is it that the consulate wants? These three factors we need to consider. One is confirmation of admission. Second, adequate qualification. And third, a financial security. We will, okay, when we talk about this, when we see this like this, this slide, we say, oh, it's that simple. You know, it's nothing about it. Okay, confirmation of admission. I have an admission letter. Yes, I have a bachelor's degree, so I'm adequately qualified to go for a master's. And of course, I have the money. So yeah, obviously, people would say that, okay, I have all the three factors. But these three factors are actually a combination of multiple aspects. And through this webinar, we are going to understand what those aspects are. Welcome to all those guys who are joining a little late. So guys, we are talking about, just to let you, to get you on the same page, we are talking about what is the most important factor when we talk about student visa interviews. how do we clear a student visa interview? How do we make sure that we are not the ones among the rejected applications? So we have focus, we need to focus on these three aspects. One is confirmation of admission. Secondly, adequate qualification. And third, financial security. As we move forward, we will be taking each one and I will be explaining to you what each aspect means. If we look at confirmation of admission, so of course, first is the admission letter, which is the most important tool that you have in your kit. If you do not have an admission letter and you say, I will go and ask for an admission letter there, or that is what the university is saying, no, you know, embassy, no consulate is ever going to believe it and they are not going to grant you visa. So admission letter is foremost important aspect. So you need to have an admission letter. Then you have fee payment receipt. Fee payment is by the time you go for your visa application, you need to pay a part of fees to the institute. And you should have a receipt of that to make the visa consulate believe in you that yes, this is what I have and this is what I'm going for. It is advisable that before you fly, you pay your 1 year fees, because even after reaching in certain countries, even after reaching the country, there is very strict scrutiny to know whether you are there for education or for some other ulterior motives. So when we talk about fee, yes, so part of fees is paid and then you have to have the remaining part in your account, about which we will be talking when we cover our financial aspects. You need to know everything about the course. Yes, when I say everything, I mean everything. You need to know what is this course about? How is it going to help you? You need to know the university. What is this university offering you? How is this and only this university relevant for your education? How is this country? What is this country? How is it? How is this country relevant to your qualification? How is it going to help you in your growth? And in the long term, how is the country going to play and the course and the university going to play a major role in your life and in your career? These answers you need to have. When you talk to the person who is taking your visa interview, you should have a clear ability to explain your academic record and why you are a credible student. You should be able to link your past achievements and your past career path and your educational qualifications to what is your future planning. And of course, to the course that you are going to pursue. A lot of people have gap in their education. Gap is often questionable unless it is absolutely explainable. Gap often scares students that, oh, I don't know whether my, because this is what usually the perception is that, okay, if you have a gap, that means you are not up to the mark. But what is it that you did in that gap? For example, you want to go abroad and study, say, music. So after your 12th, you dropped out and you learned guitar, you learned to play guitar, you learned to play piano. You did something in that relevant line. Then it explains the gap. It is a value addition. You know what you are doing. You have, you know, carved your path. You are not just getting up one day and deciding, oh, I want to learn music. So this gap explanation is very important. Do not be afraid of the gap. If you have a longer gap, then you should have a better explanation and planning pathway. You should be able to, you yourself should know about yourself. You know what you are doing, how am I going to grow, what was my plan. These things should be clear in your mind. visa consulates also look at when they are interviewing you, university reputation versus relevance. What is the reputation of this university? Is the degree valid? Do they actually teach something, or they are just granting degree for the sake of it, for earning money? That is very important. And of course, what is the relevance of this course in your life? That is of primary importance. Once again, people are looking at genuine intentions and they want to see how you can prove it. If you can prove it, there is nothing that can stop you from getting your student visa. So ultimately, it is intent of your, of your willingness, to go, your willingness to study. So your intent plus the extent of information you have about the course, the extent you are going to go to complete this course, to the extent till where you are, ready to add value more to your course and to your life is what the interviewers are looking at. Moving forward, we have adequate qualification. Now, if you have a degree, does that make your qualification adequate? That is a question to be asked to ourselves. What does your degree actually signify? A lot of times people, they are not aware of where they are going with their degrees. So they just go for it. They just do it. But they are not really utilizing it. Sometimes they even go abroad and do some sort of short-term courses, but there is no relevance of those courses in their current path, and neither after doing those courses are they utilizing it. For example, I am a counselor, I am a trainer, and I go abroad and I somehow get a visa for, say, a visitor visa, and I go abroad and I do a 2 weeks or a month or 2 months course in social media marketing. Now, social media marketing is a big thing. It's an in thing. So I come back and I say, I have a social media marketing, certification now. So when I go out in future, it will be helpful. But for years after that, I don't utilize it. Or even for months, say, I don't utilize it. My job does not require it. Or even my current field of education or my past field of education, nowhere is related to it. And then I go for a visa saying, hey, I have a social media marketing certification from certain country. And now I want to go abroad and do a master's in management, business management. How have I utilized the degree that I gained in past? That would actually signify whether my relevance, my qualification is adequate and relevant. Then, are you overqualified? Once again, this is for those people who just keep adding degrees to their resume. Just adding a degree to your resume is not going to help you if you are not utilizing it. What are you doing with that degree is very important. So when you are adding a degree to your resume, just so I have seen a lot of people, for example, who have done their master's or their bachelor's in law, but they are actually running a business or they are actually, pursuing something else. So what is that degree for? Just because they wanted to have some professional degree on their resume, they did that. My friends, it does not work like that. People who are granting visas are very careful about these little aspects. They want to see that once this person goes into my country, how is this person going to add value to my country? And also, when he comes back or when he goes anywhere else, what is the value that he is going to carry and what is the impression that he is going to give? Now, if you are going for any of the STEM subjects, STEM is science, technology, engineering, and medical. These are the shortage skill subjects. These are the skills which are really short. And, you know, these kind of visas can get approved very quickly. So when you are talking about adequate qualification, one is your qualification should have some paths. Their path should be seen. A course should be seen of your qualification, and thus you should, your future path should be carved in that way. You should be ready to do that. You should be aware of that. If you are too much educated, that can also be a reason for rejection. Yes, it may sound surprising, but it is true. So there have been cases in past where a person has an admission letter from the university, but the person sitting at the consulate or the embassy feels that, okay, you have this degree, you have this degree, and you have four other degrees. So what is the use of this degree in your life? We don't feel you require it. Reject it. And once it is rejected, it is stamped on your visa. So be very careful. You cannot fool those people. Once again, you have to be genuine. You have to be real about what you are talking. You should know what you are talking. Moving on, we will be talking about financial security. When we talk about financial security, we need to consider all the factors. And by all the factors, I mean not just your study expense, but also your living expense. So as we were talking about fees earlier, I will continue with that and I will give more explanation on that. When we talk about fees, so before you go for your visa application, there is a percentage of fees that you should have paid to the university, and you should have a proof of that. And the remaining fees needs to be in your bank. Along with the fees, you need to have amount of living expenses that you will be requiring in the next coming year in your bank. So different country has different ways of assessing, your financial security. So a lot of them would require your bank statement, but the intention is same, to understand whether you are a genuine student or not. Sometimes you might have to show source of income, whether it is your income or your sponsor's income. So if you say you have a sponsor, you need to carry the documents, source of income documents for of your sponsor's annual income. It is very important. So these factors, if you are talking about a bank loan, that you are taking a loan, you need to have those documents ready with you. If somebody in the family is helping you, so you need to have their records as well, their income proof, their bank balance records. So all these factors you need to consider. Just having money is not enough to get a student visa interview again, but it shows your intention. Relevant documents play a very, very important role. And we help our students understand how do they play a role in that, your visa application. Next, we will be talking about the do's of a visa interview. Now, at Zoom Abroad, we take care that all our students get the best of advice and support when they are going for visa interviews. If you are not confident, please get help. Please get professional help. Because a little mistake, even one single missing date or a document, can cause a visa refusal. So let's see what are the do's of applying for a visa, student visa. First of all, is being present, relevant, and presentable. It may sound silly, but there are people who take appointment and do not appear for visa interview for reason whatsoever. It is not appreciated, and it is absolutely a no-no. So no matter what, be present for your visa interview and be there before time so that you have enough time to relax yourself and be confident enough about the interview. You do not want to go there all huffing and puffing and, you know, looking stressed out. Be relevant. You should have, when we talk about being relevant, we are talking about actual proof of being relevant. Not just, you know, all the talking that you're doing. A lot of people say, hey, I'm very good at fabricating stories. I can fabricate any story at last minute. No, it doesn't help, my friends. You have to be relevant with proof and facts and figures. You should have all the documents and in correct order and format. Once again, if you are not confident about the documents and their relevance and their order and format, get professional help. At Zoom Abroad, we help our students, and it is a complimentary service that we provide with the application that we are processing for them for foreign universities. But if you are not confident, once again, get professional help. Do not leave anything for the last minute or for just, you know, on your gut feeling, because the visa rejection stays there permanently. Be presentable. Grooming is very important. Do not go there looking like a hippie, though I have no, you know, I have no offense, and I absolutely adore hippie culture, but be presentable. Be formal when you are going there. Be in your best shape. Be in your best attitude. Right attitude is very, very important. You need to be polite. You cannot. Sometimes visa interviewers can get really, you may feel that, okay, what is this person asking? Am I like a thief? No, you are not a thief. But they have the right to ask you questions because you are entering their home country. So have the right attitude. They may even ask you to write your own SOP at the last minute. SOP is statement of purpose. You cannot say, hey, why are you asking me to do that? Because it is their right, and you should be able to do it last minute and write correct information. Everything that comes out of your mouth should be true. Everything should be verifiable. You cannot just fabricate stories there. Before going for an interview, you need to practice conversation and not just transmission. Conversing with people is very important, and it is obviously easiest when you are confident. So when you practice transmission, you become like a robot there. You just go sit and keep on saying things without waiting for the other person to say. So make it a conversation. Whenever you're getting into a practice, get into a conversational practice. It will also boost your confidence. And when you are actually doing it, you will be at ease. Knowing about your college course, the country where you're going, and your own SOP is absolutely the most important thing, guys. I cannot stress it enough. It's if it is not done right, then there is no chance that you can get a visa. So, what college are you going in? How is it, once again, how is it relevant to you? The course that you are doing, how is it adding value to you? The country that you are going to, why do you want to go to that country only? And the SOP again, statement of purpose. Why are you choosing this college? Why are you applying for this course? How is this course going to help you? What have you done in the past that shows that you are relevant for this course? These are some factors that the visa interviewers would be looking at. Never rush to apply for any course. A lot of students get excited when they see that, oh, I am eligible to get admission in XYZ college. Of course, you need to have all the degrees and the documents ready. If your country is some country where English language is not a first language, then whatever university that you're applying to, according to that, you should have the IELTS or TOEFL exam given and the score ready with you. If it is awaited, you should have some proof of given that you have given this exam. After all this, you need to go and apply for visa. It takes time. You cannot think that, I have everything. Maybe just one document is missing. So what? In 2 months, it might be there. You need to assess how much time it takes. And if you're living in a country which does not have a particular embassy, then you have to look at the factor, because a lot of time people go to a neighboring country to apply for visas as well, where they do not have an embassy. So you have to keep into mind that if something of that sort happens, how am I going to deal with it? So keep ample time in your hand before applying. Book appointment in time. And if they say that, okay, you are already late now, the course might start by the time your visa comes. So do not keep stressing on, oh, maybe I'll join next season, maybe I'll join next batch. Do not stress on deferring to next intake. Plan well and plan ahead and book your appointment. With this, we come to the end of our this session. And now I will open the platform for any questions that you might have. Okay, so we have a question from one of our participants, Saurabh. He is asking, do the gap year should have valid paper records or only learning can satisfy visa officer during the Q&A? Saurabh and all the other attendees, it's good if you have valid paper record. It is always, an admissible proof, a fact sheet is always good to have. But if you do not have a valid paper record, you must have utilized it somewhere. It must be visible somewhere in your work areas. You need to have that much at least with you. So that is going to be very helpful for you. But if you want more advice, I'll be really happy to connect with you offline. So guys, do we have any more questions? Okay, so looks like we do not have any further questions. But guys, if you have any questions, you can always write to me on Tanu, T-A-N-U, Tanu, dot Pareek, P-A-R-E-E-K, at zoomabroad.com. Please write to me on this email ID with your questions and I'll be addressing them. Thank you for joining this webinar. Have a nice day.